In this video, we'll explore some of the most powerful features of the paintbrush tool, from the basic brush settings to how more advanced brushes work. I'll take you through the essential settings that can help you get the most out of your photo editing. By the end of this video, you'll have a better understanding of the paintbrush tool and how to use it to take your photo editing to the next level. When using the brush tool, it helps to have the colour and brushy studio panels visible. If you can't see them, check they're visible using the window menu. If there's a tick to the left of the name, it's already visible. If not, click it once. In the Brushy Studio panel, the brushes are organised into categories. I have the basic category selected, but if I click on the drop-down, you can see some of the others. These are typically arranged by media type, like oils and watercolours, and we'll take a look at some of these later. When I click on one of the brush presets, it sets the brush controls in the Affinity Photo toolbar. For example, a brush preset may change the size of the brush, or perhaps the hardness, or the flow. Let's look at what some of these basic controls do, because I know there are some misconceptions amongst photographers. The width slider is how we change the size of the brush, but there's also a useful keyboard shortcut that I prefer. Use the left square bracket key to make the brush smaller, and the right square bracket key to make it larger. This is the default setting for most installations, but some countries may be different. I find it's better to use the bracket keys because you can position your brush over the image whilst you're resizing it. Now when I click once with my mouse, it paints a black circle. That's because I'm using black paint. You can see this at the bottom of the tool's palette, where there's a black disc on top of a white disc. These discs are the foreground and background colours in Affinity Photo. You can switch between the two by clicking the small curved arrow just below the discs. Alternatively, you can press X on your keyboard. If I double click on the foreground colour disc, it opens a colour picker dialog, which I can use to change the colour. Notice also that when I move the brush, I see a preview of what it'll paint with if I click. This lasts a few seconds and then vanishes. Now a quick way to reset the foreground and background colours to black and white is to press D on your keyboard. Did you notice that when I painted the black disc, I only needed to click once with my mouse? We can control this behaviour by using the opacity and flow sliders. When these are at full strength like they are now, each click or brush stroke produces the foreground colour at full strength. Watch what happens though when I reduce the opacity to 10% and paint with black. This time I produce a light grey disc. Then, if I click a second time, and then a third time, the paint builds up to become darker. Let's reset the opacity now and reduce the flow to 10% instead. Now when I paint the three overlapping discs, it looks exactly the same. But there's an important difference between the two settings. Let's go back to using a low opacity with a flow at full strength. This time I'm going to click and paint whilst holding down my mouse button. Notice that I can paint over a large area to produce a consistent light grey colour. Then, if I release the mouse button and paint over the area a second time, it builds up the effect. Let's do the same now using a low flow, but a 100% opacity setting. This time the effect of the paint builds up as I actually move my paintbrush over the same area. What's happening is that the lower flow setting causes the paint to be applied gradually until it reaches the value set by the opacity slider. For example, if I reduce the opacity to 50% and then paint over an area, the darkest the area becomes is a mid-tone grey. Let's reset the opacity now to 100% because there's something else I want to show you. Notice that as I'm painting, I'm producing lots of separate discs that are overlapping. This also happened when I used the lower opacity setting with 100% flow, but it wasn't as obvious. Another way to make the effect less obvious is to reduce the brush hardness. This softens the edge of the brush, making the different discs blend into each other. The reason this is important when editing is that it could make your changes visible. Let's set the hardness back to 100% because we need to look at some more controls. If I click the More button, it opens the Affinity Photo dialog where I have a lot more settings I can use. In fact, there are so many settings here that they're arranged into four separate tabs. What we've just been looking at is the spacing between the circles in the brush stroke. This is controlled by the spacing slider. When I increase this, it increases the space between the circles, which you can see in the dialog preview. If I don't want to see a space between the circles, I can reduce the slider right the way down to 1%. Then when I paint a new brushstroke, it looks smooth and black. The reason it looks black rather than light grey now is that there are lots of discs being painted over each other. It's only at either end of the brushstroke that you see them fading out. To produce a grey brushstroke rather than a black, I could reduce the flow further, down to 1%. Now my brushstrokes look grey, but I can still build up the colour density if I paint over the area for long enough. Using these general controls together can produce lots of different and interesting effects. But you can also go much further using other brush controls. Let's reset the brush and change to another. In the Alls category, I'll select the Fine Fibers brush. This sets the size, opacity, flow and hardness settings as before. But notice what's happened in the brush preview as I move my mouse around. The brush tip is made up of just a few speckles rather than being a solid circle. Also, the brush tip is rotating and juddering as it's moved. Using brushes like this can bring a new level of refinement to your photo editing. Don't just limit yourself to the basic circular brush. Now let's click the More button and open the dialog. I want to show you some of the settings to control the effects you're seeing. For example, we can increase the spacing and reduce the accumulation setting. This produces a lighter paint buildup as if I was using thinner oils to paint with. Let's switch now to the Dynamic tab, where you can see the settings producing the judder when I'm painting. If I set the rotation jitter to 0%, you can see that the brush tip is stable now when I paint. Then, if I switch to the Textures tab, you can even see the shape of the brush tip. It's these settings in this dialog that are creating the special brush effects that you see. But let me give you a word of warning. If you're going to experiment with your brush settings, it's best to first create a duplicate brush. If you do forget to do this, you can always use the reset button to go back to the default for that brush. Now, once you've created a custom brush, you can also share it with other Affinity Photo users by exporting it. You can do this from the menu at the top right of the Brushes Studio panel. This is also where you can import custom brushes from other people, like this custom watermark brush I created. And if you want to know how to create your own custom watermark brush, you'll need to watch this video next. Thanks for watching today, and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already. I'll see you soon for another video.